Graham Alachi here from Building Blocks for Modern Humans. Thank you for joining me once again. In our last episode, we talked about energy, the master resource that powers all of modern human existence. We talked about what energy is, how we can transform it from one form to another, how we can transfer it from one place to another. And we also looked at the energy mix of where humans get energy from and the relative amounts of that, which we'll go over and get in a second. What I'd like to do is start a series on each of those energy sources and talk about what they are, why we use them, what we use them for in particular, some of their benefits, some of their drawbacks. And today we are going to start with coal. So today's video is all about coal. If you want to learn about coal and the history of why humans started using it in the first place and what we use it for today and why it has drawbacks, but it's still really important, then stick with me. And if you've made it this far, please remember to like this video. It really helps with the YouTube algorithm. I would really appreciate it. And if you enjoy this content, please subscribe for more in the future. So, coal, let's get to it. Coal is, simply put, a hard black rock that humans can dig out of the ground and grind up. And when we do that, we can burn it and it releases a lot of heat. We can use that heat directly to heat buildings, to heat homes, to power industrial processes, or we can transform it into other forms of energy, namely electricity, which I'll mention in just a moment. The use of coal dates back to about 6,000 years ago in China. And in England, they've been using it for about the last 1,000 years. And now its use is pretty ubiquitous worldwide. A lot of people are using it for heat, for other chemical processes, and also to produce electricity, which is the biggest reason we use coal to this day. To get coal, we have to mine it. And there's two main ways to do this. You can either find it near the surface of the earth, which is a great thing because you just have to go in there and start digging it, like you see here. Or sometimes it's much deeper and we have to build mine shafts and do underground mines, which is what you might think of when you think of coal. And really, as I'll explain later in this video, some of the best forms of coal, the highest quality coal, is really deep down. So we build these mine shafts and we send people down there to dig it out and bring it back to the surface.
Here's a map of different coal deposits found worldwide. You can see it's found a lot in the northern hemisphere, in the upper half here, and there's a lot less in the southern hemisphere. But you can see that there's a reason why we use so much coal. One of the reasons is we can find it almost anywhere. Here's a graph of coal production over time from the year 1900 to about 2019. You'll see that after the year 1980, we see a rapid rise in the amount of coal being produced worldwide, and it's largely from one country, and that's China, a country that developed rapidly in terms of energy production from 1980 onwards. So what I'd like to do now is review how coal fits into the worldwide energy mix. So once again, from the International Energy Administration, the IEA, we have the world total energy supply for the year 2019, which is pretty similar to what we have today here in 2023. If you look at the top right in this light blue portion of the donut chart here, you'll see coal provides 26.8% of all the energy that humans use worldwide. That is a huge amount that is second only to oil, coming in at 30.9%, which we'll look at in another video. This is a huge amount. In fact, the IEA estimates that in 2022, humans consumed over 8 billion tons of coal. So it's a huge amount. Again, this is the primary energy mix, meaning this is the first time we use the energy before we transform it into any other forms. So real quick, let's take a look at the final consumption of the energy and how much coal provides for that. So here we have, for the same year, 2019, the world total final energy consumption from the IEA. So this is the form of energy that humans actually use it in for the purposes of what they want it for, whatever that happens to be. What you'll see here is coal is now only 9.5% of this mix, down from 26.8%, which is a big change. And that's because the coal energy that we use is typically transformed into electricity. You'll see electricity here is 19.7% of the energy we use in its final form. So to give you some reference here, over 90% of the coal consumed in the United States is for transformation into electricity. So we burn the coal and we use the heat in a coal power plant to create electricity. In fact, worldwide, coal accounts for 37% of the world electricity production in general. So that's a big reason why we use coal, is we burn it for the heat and we transform that heat into electricity.
So what do we use coal for? As I've mentioned already many times, the number one use of coal in the world today is to produce electricity. The way it works is we burn coal, we take that heat, and we boil water. You'll find the vast majority of electricity production in the world comes from boiling water and running it through what's known as a steam turbine. When the pressurized steam goes through the steam turbine, it spins, and that spinning is connected to a generator, which produces electricity that we can send all sorts of places to be used as electric power, generally in its final form, as a final consumption. Before using coal for electric power, it was used to produce mechanical power using what's known as a steam engine. These aren't used very much anymore, but these powered trains for a really long time and was a massive improvement for productivity worldwide. So burning coal to produce steam and running it through an engine that produced mechanical movement was a huge boon to humans. And we can thank, well, any sort of burning, but at the time it was primarily coal. We can also use coal to produce steel. What we do is we combine iron ore with a product of coal, which is called coke, which is coal that's been heated up in the absence of oxygen, or at least oxygen-starved environments, to produce something that burns crazy hot. So we add a rock, which is iron ore, which is a rock that contains some iron, and we combine that with coke at the top of the blast furnace, and there's a bunch of thermal and chemical reactions that eventually bring the iron out of the iron ore and into a form that we can eventually turn into steel. This is the number one way of making steel worldwide. Humans are working on ways to replace coal, but this is still the primary way that we do it to this day.
Additionally, coal can be used to create all sorts of different chemicals. I found this graphic on Wikipedia. I don't want to get into all the details of this because it would be a video in and of itself, maybe a series of videos, but you can see coal coming in from the left, that blue box there, and through the process of gasification, turning into all sorts of different chemicals that we can use industrially.
So coal. What is it exactly? We saw these black rocks, but where did they come from? So coal, along with petroleum or oil and natural gas, are what's known as fossil fuels. It's ancient plants and animals that were buried underground, and over long periods of time, there were transformations that occurred that produced these types of fuels that could be burned to release heat. Coal in particular is ancient forests, ancient vegetation that was buried underground and starts to decay and turns into something called peat, which is a precursor to coal. And then a bunch of stuff piles on top of it over the years. I'm talking millions of years. And the heat and the pressure causes a process called coalification, where it over time turns into different types of coal. And we'll go over the different types of coal in just a moment. But that's what it is. It's ancient forests that were buried underground. And that's why some of these are at the surface and some of them are much deeper. It depends how far below it was buried. From an elemental point of view, like when we talked about the elements of the periodic table in a few videos before, what is coal? Well, I went online and I got an elemental breakdown of what a typical sample of coal might look like, and here it is. As you'll see, it's 84.4% on average in a normal type of coal, carbon, which is element number 6. It is atomic number 6, which means there's 6 protons and nucleus. This is what combines with oxygen to produce carbon dioxide. And it's that reaction of combining carbon with oxygen, producing carbon dioxide, that releases a lot of heat. This is what sustains the flames of the chemical reaction of burning coal and most fossil fuels. Additionally, number 2, we're coming in with 5.4% hydrogen. That hydrogen as well can combine with oxygen to produce H2O, which is water. That also releases heat. So these two reactions of carbon and hydrogen combining with oxygen,
and this oxygen comes from the air we breathe,
release heat and causes these flames, and that's why these fuels are valuable.
So it may interest you to know that there's different types of coals, and this graphic's going to help us in understanding that. So like I said before, it starts off as a swampy, bog-like environment, or like an ancient forest, which you see here on the top left in this green part of the graphic. As it gets buried, it turns into peat, which is partially decayed organic matter. Over time, with increasing pressure and temperature, as it's buried underground, it turns into the lowest grade of coal, which is lignite, which is also known as brown coal, and then eventually, with further time and pressure and burial, turns into the black coals. Here's another way of looking at it. So this is a graphic that's been adapted from the University of Kentucky. Again, with time and burial and heat and pressure, we start off as peat, we turn into lignite, and then the black coals can be broken into sub-bituminous, bituminous, and the highest grade of coal, which burns super clean, well, relatively clean for coal, and it has a lot of heat content, is the highest grade anthracite. So these are the different types of coal. The time and pressure and depth are so important. There's actually a law called Hilt's Law, which basically says the deeper that the coal is, the more likely you are to get a high grade and eventually anthracite. So the deeper, the better when it comes to the grade of coal.
So I mentioned I was going to talk about some of the drawbacks of coal. And the truth is, coal can cause adverse effects to human health. The dust, when you mine coal and you grind it all up, the dust, when inhaled, can affect your lungs negatively. There's something called black lung that coal miners get. They used to get it a lot more, and now we have more protection when we're mining. But it is a cause of disease in humans. The combustion of coal as well can cause certain toxins to be released into the air. There's other stuff in coal that, when burned, you produce all these excess gases that go up the top of the power plant, and these can affect human health negatively. When you're done burning the coal, there is solid matter left over, and it's known as ash. And this stuff, when exposed to humans and other life forms again, can be toxic. So we have to be careful when we burn coal, and there are downsides to its use, no question. Additionally, you may have heard of the greenhouse effect. And what that means is there are types of gases known as greenhouse gases that absorb heat. And when these gases increase in concentration in the atmosphere, there is a theory, and it's the prevailing theory in the scientific community, that this could lead to an increase in temperature on planet Earth. And this is a cause of global warming or climate change. So coal in particular is very carbon rich. And when carbon combines with oxygen to release heat, it produces CO2, carbon dioxide. This carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. So the combustion of these types of fuels, fossil fuels that are rich in carbon, are known to increase the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere, and this might change our climate. In fact, that's the prevailing theory. So that's another downside to using coal, is the increase of CO2 in the atmosphere.
Now, with all those downsides of coal I just talked about, you might be confused to hear about the fact that there is such thing as clean coal combustion technology. To a certain degree, that's for real. Here's an example of what that might look like. So we have the coal supply coming in, gets burned in the boiler to create steam, and thus the steam creates electricity as per normal. But the flue gas, so after you burn the coal, the gases that come out that contain all the pollutants, they're just cleaned up a little bit. We have the flue gas desulfurization unit getting rid of some of the sulfur, which can cause sulfur oxides and acid rain. And then we have the fabric filter, or the ESP, which is the electrostatic precipitators, gets rid of the tiny particulates, which are hazardous to human health. And additionally, the SCR, or the SNCR, the selective catalytic reduction unit, or selective non-catalytic reduction unit, which lowers the nitrogen oxide content, which is another pollutant that we have to control for. So the one thing that these technologies don't do is lessen the CO2 emissions. So they do clean it up when it comes to the short-term human health effects and effects on other life, but for its impact on the climate, according to the anthropogenic greenhouse gas model, none of this clean coal stuff does anything at all for CO2 emissions. There is another technology that falls under the clean coal umbrella called carbon capture and sequestration. This means that the CO2 in the flue gas is actually separated out to be stored somewhere so it's not released into the atmosphere. Some of this technology does work. It's not really used all that much in the world yet because the economics are rough from my understanding, but I'm not an expert on this yet. I just wanted to introduce the topic a little bit.
All right, everyone. Thanks for joining me on this video. This was an introduction to coal. We're going to talk about coal more in the future, but that's enough of an introduction for now. In the next episode, I'm going to talk about oil and petroleum products, the next type of fossil fuel, our next energy source. If you haven't done so already, please like this video. It really helps the YouTube algorithm. I'd really appreciate it. And if you want to see more content like this in the future, please subscribe to this channel. If you have any questions, drop them into the comments below and I will answer. Thank you so much, and we'll see you next time.